You know what they haven't met about you? They haven't met your heart. They haven't met your spirit. They haven't met your soul. They haven't met your process, and they by sure haven't met our seniors and their struggle. If they gave me one word to describe you right now, man, that would be a trailblazer. You know what trailblazers do? They blaze trails for other people to become elite. And when you come out of that tunnel tonight, you'll see Bronco Nation erupt. You have blazed trails for others who thought this was never possible. Yes, in my opinion, you're a trailblazer. You're legendary. Let's go live out as legends tonight. Let's go roll the ball.
All right, I'm leaving. I'm playing. Who wouldn't want to run out of a locker room through a tunnel and play for PJ Fleck? That is the type of spirit that this group rallies around. And that's why they're 13-0. And Brock, where will your eyes be early matchups that are key to watch?
I think for the first time ever in the history of doing these games, it will be on special teams, because I think Western Michigan is going to be hyper aggressive, just like their head coach you just heard from. And that could be on this kickoff. That could be in punts. It could be in their own territory. So don't turn away when special teams begin. And then it's about Wisconsin's power run. And we're going to get to see that in mere moments. They're bigger. They're faster. They're stronger. But Western Michigan believes not just in their heart, they believe in their lateral quickness, and it's going to have to be top-notch against the power and strength of the Badgers.
Latrell Jamerson back deep to receive the opening kick from Derek Mitchell, and it will come out to the 25-yard line. You mentioned the power run game, and it focuses around Corey Clement.
He's gotten better and better as this season has evolved. And I don't think it's any surprise that timing was coinciding with an O-line that came together. Same guys that played the last 6 weeks. They're led by their left tackle. Ryan Ramczyk is a monster. You can see the productivity over the last 5, 7 of 8 as well, with 100-plus yards. And he wants to finish his career strong this afternoon.
He averages just a shade under 109 per game, the leading rusher in the Big Ten. And that takes a lot of pressure off of the quarterback as Bart Houston gets the start. But we will see Alex Hornibrook at some point. How about a jet sweep to start the game? Quintez Cephas turns the corner. And he's got a first down, a gain of 14 on the opening play. As we take a look at today's Chick-fil-A impact players.
Corey's going to get his touches. You're going to see a multiplicity of looks and formations and movements. Ramczyk will have hip surgery when this year ends. I think that speaks volumes of his toughness. And on the other side, Spillane, the leading tackler, well over 100. And keep an eye on Justin Tranquil, just a redshirt freshman. But he's got to limit the big play. Wisconsin will get some runs. They're going to hit some creases. They just can't be home runs for Western Michigan.
Our first flag, and a rare one at that, against Wisconsin.
Before the snap, false start, number 85. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Only Navy was penalized less this year than Wisconsin. The Badgers only averaged 3.3 penalties per game. They had 4 games this season with 1 penalty or no penalties at all.
That speaks to what Allison was saying for Paul Chris. These guys are ready to hit. And Western Michigan stepping up into the gap. These guys want to go attack an undersized opponent. They're the heavyweight. They want that middleweight to feel their presence.
Clement gets outside. He's got a first down and more. Finally brought down inside the Western Michigan 45 by Devontae Ginwright. That's a gain of 23.
And that's that power run game. They want to wash you down. Look at the point of attack here. Look at the big fellas on the right. Wash it down. An excellent job by Dietzen, the left guard. An even better job from Fumagalli, the tight end, to have his eyes up. And you give Clement the edge, you're going to be in trouble this afternoon.
How much of giving up that edge early for Western Michigan is the paranoia of trying to get muscle in the middle because you're expecting the run to come down?
100%.
Now it's Tywan Deal in the game at tailback. There's the straight ahead run. A gain of 9.
And then get used to it. And this is exactly what Paul Chris wanted. And this is exactly what Western Michigan and Ed Pinkham, their defensive coordinator, did not want to see. They cannot let Wisconsin get their hands on them. That was the messaging all day yesterday at walkthrough. right? You have got to get on an edge, and right now you are seeing a tremendous job of those tight ends and fullbacks, linemen of Wisconsin, targeting those blocks, and they get their body on these Western Michigan defenders. There's upwards of 40-pound advantages across the board.
Deal again. And this time the middle stacked, and it will be a third down. Third down and short coming up for the Badgers. But David Curl was the first there for the Bronx to make that stop. Lemon back in the game for third down and one. Lemon straight ahead. First down to the 29-yard line. Ethan Braister may have saved a really big game with an ankle tackle.
What did you say to me earlier? That run game takes the pressure off the quarterback. How about every single play you've come out and established that run? That was going to be the script for Bart Houston to follow today. He's earned this right. He's the redshirt senior that if Western Michigan has a gritty story on their side, Bart absolutely does as well, as he watched a redshirt freshman, Hornibrook, take his job earlier this season. But that grit has worn out or proven successful here at the end, and why he's earned this right to start today.
He had a very solid Big Ten championship game with Hornibrook injured in the regular season finale for the Badger. And now Clement tripped up at the line. A gain of only about a yard and a half.
And that was a much better job up front of Andre Turner, the defensive tackle, of getting on that edge. David Curl, Andre Turner, the guys in the middle, they've got to allow Robert Spillane there, number 10, our impact linebacker, they have got to allow him to be free, because he'll finish tackles. He's more than capable. He had 25 scholarship offers to lots of schools, but he's going to need the help, as any linebacker does, with those big bodies in front.
Play action, the first throw for Bart Houston. It's a little screen out to the edge to Troy Fumagalli, and it fooled no one, least of all, Asante Brown. That's a loss of about four, maybe five. Now it's third and 13.
And you have a little slower developing play. You're gonna give an opportunity for that quickness to win out, and you see exactly that. It is a perfect picture of a converted safety in Asante Brown, who's now a strong side linebacker at 200 pounds, and he simply gets out in front of the center, Michael Dieter, there. That quickness over the speed and power, and a very desirable third and 13 if you're a Western Michigan fan.
And the Western Michigan fans realize how important this play is. Houston off play action, up the seam. Fumagalli hauls it in with a flag down. What a catch by the redshirt junior tight end.
That penalty's declined. Results of the play. Completed catch. First down.
You know, Bob, I love to ask these coaches every week, give me a matchup. Give me something that you think in this game that you can take advantage of. And this was the one. Paul Chris didn't really point to any other. And you see the hands there. It was actually the linebacker, Brown. Not the safety, but he said Fumagalli's got some opportunities, either against undersized linebackers or safeties that don't match up. Expect to see his number called a bunch. We've already seen it in both pass plays, right to the tight end, number 81.
Ninth play of the drive. Another end around, this one to Jazz Peavy. This time the Broncos were ready for it. No gain on first down. Sam Beal stayed home. And if there are some actual Cowboy fans in the building, probably felt like they were watching Jason Witten a moment ago.
That's right. Much like the Cowboys, the number one seed in the NFC, run the ball, take the air out of the ball, and then make big plays on third down. And Witten's been doing it, Des Bryant's been doing it, and Fumagalli can't do it much better than that. That's tight coverage, too. That was a little zone defender over the top. He had to break that in. Pretty good trust there between quarterback and tight end.
A former walk-on, part of that walk-on culture in Madison. Clement, right up the gut, inside the five, close to a first down. Let's see where they mark him down. Is it first and goal? Needed to get to the 2-yard line, just about got right there.
What a great block from Xander Neville there, the tight end, the fourth tight end. Expect to see fullbacks galore, tight ends. This is where they love to get their fullbacks involved, both in the passing game and Austin Ramish, Alec Ingold, those two fullbacks, five rushing touchdowns as well.
Lemon. Into the end zone. That's a Wisconsin touchdown. Endicott tacks on the point, an 11-play drive, 9 runs. Corey Clement gets Wisconsin on the board first. Welcome back to the 2017 Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic here at AT&T Stadium. And Wisconsin with a very Wisconsin-esque drive to take the early lead. Coming up later on ESPN, 2 more games for you. At 5, it's the granddaddy of them all. The Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual, USC, Penn State, and wrap up the day with Auburn and Oklahoma in the All-State Sugar Bowl. Both games streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Darius Phillips will bring it out for Western Michigan. And won't get far. Cut down at the 14-yard line. So Western Michigan will have the football when we return for the first time. Can they answer? We'll find out. Rained all night here in Dallas, but it turned into a beautiful day outside AT&T Stadium. A day to tailgate at the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Take your selfies, and aerial coverage is provided by Goodyear, committed to honoring blimp-worthy athletes who demonstrate hard work on and off the field. Goodyear, the official sponsor of the college football playoff.
Get 84 involved early, and won't surprise me if there is a shot on the first series. He's the best player on the field for Western Michigan.
Corey Davis at the top of your screen, split out wide to the right. Play action. Zach Terrell right to his favorite target. Catch and run for Corey Davis to the 37-yard line. The all-time FBS leader closing in on 5,300 career yards.
Yeah, we ran through all the firsts for the program, but when you're number one all-time in the history of this game at something, you can't be talked about enough. And no one has ran, caught more yards than Corey Davis. Over 5,000 yards, almost 3 miles in his career. He is a remarkable talent.
Zach Terrell, right back to the slant. This time it's incomplete. Threw it a bit behind Michael Henry. Derek Tindall was there in coverage. Let's check in again with Allison.
And PJ Fleck will tell you, when it comes to Corey Davis, he is the hardest worker on this team, and he is a team guy. It's the reason he came back. He could have potentially been a second round pick in the NFL last year, but he told his coach, I know how good this team is going to be, and I can't stand the thought of watching them potentially play in a New Year's Six game from home. He wanted to be out there today for moments like this.
To the ground for the first time. A gain of a couple of yards. Jamari Bogan, but that's a bit of a veiled comment to some of the players that sat out their team's bowl games this year to get ready for the National Football League. That is a guy that absolutely is projected by most to, if not be in the first round, at worst be in the second round. And here he is playing on this final stage, you would think, with his teammates. Third down and 8. Terrell under pressure, hurls one to the sideline, and no chance to find Carrington Thompson. T.J. Watt got the pressure on for Wisconsin, and it will be a Broncos punt.
He's the Big Ten's best. I think this is going to be his final game. He'll have a decision. I think he goes pro. 10.5 sacks, and you can just see the hands in the technique. No surprise. He's watched his brother do it at the professional level. He's got every tool that you want in that tool bag. Now be alert for special teams all game long.
James Coleman kicks it away. And a fair catch is made at about the 12-yard line by Peavy. Wisconsin has the football back after a 49-yard punt. welcome you back with a look at today's AT&T Inside Access. Western Michigan traveling to Dallas. Pretty cool. They put a GoPro up in the cockpit of the airplane. They arrive in Dallas to buses that are wrapped with their logo and all the players, the police escort to the hotel. And PJ Fleck leads the Broncos through the crowd that was waiting for them. And this is the hospitality suite that the players had a chance to spend their off time in when they were at the hotel. I would venture to say there's not much that looks like that back in Kalamazoo that Western Michigan enjoys on a week-by-week basis. That's the special experience of earning your right to play in a game like this.
First time in the history of the program, and their fans have traveled. They have packed this place. Pretty cool to see.
Corey Clement on first down. And speaking of Corey Clement, as he picks up about three there, his touchdown run, it was perfection.
Do yourself a favor today. Don't just watch the ball. Watch the left tackle. And then watch the Polars for Wisconsin today. This is a thing of beauty. We love to watch the passing game and the precision and anticipation of throwing it. Look at this. This is called parting the Red Sea. And it's perfect colors. That's exactly what this red and white team wants to do all day long. They want to wash you down. And Ramchek's one of the best in all of college football at it. The NFL desires him. And whether he goes out with his hip surgery is another question, but can't do it better than that.
Blitz coming. Wide open, Agumbawale. Out to the 39-yard line. Western Michigan sent the blitz, and Bart Houston beat it with the quick flip to Dare Ogunbowale.
And right now, Wisconsin, this could not live out and play out any better with how they've scripted this game. And you're right. You're trying to bring a little pressure because you've got to get on an edge. You can't allow those guys to just wear and wash you down. But when you do, well, you've got a fifth-year senior that's pretty adept. They don't throw it much. But when they do, 71% as a passer his last five games. And he finds Ogunbowale out of the backfield.
Quintez Cephas takes the jet sweep. He gets outside contain again. All the way down to the Broncos 40-yard line. That's a gain of 21 more. Actually, they'll mark him down at the 41, so it's a gain of 20.
Isn't this fun to watch? You know, Paul Chris, one of the better play callers in college football, in my book. And you give him a month of opportunity, he knows what Western Michigan is wanting to do. Are they going to want to pack that box? What's he doing the very first play of the game? Fly sweep. You know, this is his answer. He doesn't have a zone read quarterback, but that fly sweep is his answer to that backside contain. Take advantage.
Play action. Houston on a rollout. There goes Corey Clement. Another chunk play for Wisconsin. Let's check in with Allison.
The Western Michigan defensive coordinator Ed Pinkham told us they spent extra time on how they would fit the gaps, and that's exactly what David Duggan, linebacker coach, was talking to his guys about extensively after that first drive, reminding them to read the flow to fit the zone. He also emphasized inside leverage, saying we can't be in Clement's tracks. We have to keep that leverage and allow that safety to come down.
And you know what, Allison, on the other side, Paul Chris is going to counter, right? He's going to expect that that would be the messaging for Western Michigan. So it's outside play pass. It's outside fly sweep. A move ahead. That's what the great play callers always are on either side of the ball.
And now P.J. Fleck calls a timeout on defense. They've already run two jet sweeps to Quintez Cephas. He had only carried the ball three times all season coming into today. As soon as we're done in Arlington, we will take you to Pasadena and the path to the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. Brock, eerily similar for both USC and Penn State.
Yeah, built this season, built on early season adversity. And man, do they ever believe behind their quarterbacks, a redshirt freshman, Sam Darnold for SC. We've seen Trace McSorley call three of his games, and all he does is win. You can ask Wisconsin. They were up 28-7 on them. Thought they had Penn State done, and they overcame that as well. Two of the hottest teams going in college football.
Let's see the effect of that timeout just called by P.J. Fleck. Corey Clement tries the right side. It was almost as if P.J. Fleck was a basketball coach, and he needed a timeout just to stop the run, to get his team to take a deep breath and gather themselves, and they get a tackle for loss from Keon Adams. on the next play.
Yeah, I think that's really well said. I think that is spot on. And he's not surprised. He knows that Wisconsin is going to run. But it was third and 13 on the first drive. That was the killer where they could not get off the field. They've got to create a negative play. They've got to put Wisconsin into passing situations. And when they do, well, there's their advantage, or their at least opportunity to get off the field.
And there might be one here on second and 13. They'll run it instead with Ogunbowale, and he gets the edge again. A freeway to the pylon. Is he in? Just short. It'll be first and goal at the one. It looked like Dare Ogunbowale was about to score.
You've said it already two or three times. You're playing the odds. You're trying to play within the tackles, right? You're trying to commit those resources, but Wisconsin is showing you they're athletic. They're fast. You think you're quicker than we are. You're not. Ogunbowale gets outside once again. Tremendous blocks. Jazz PV number 11 down the field. And if you're not watching the left tackle, you're missing something. Ramczyk is a difference maker.
Ogunbowale. That's a Wisconsin touchdown. Their second rushing touchdown to start the game. We do have a flag down on the near side of the field, but it looks like offsides
offside
on the Broncos.
Defense.
The first real adversity that PJ Fleck's team has faced this season, now down by a couple of touchdowns. They were in a real tussle in the MAC championship game and held off Ohio, but they won every regular season game in conference by at least two scores. How do they respond now?
Yeah, well, they have never, though, in this run, faced an opponent like this. You go through MAC play, and they beat Illinois, and they beat Northwestern, but they're not power football teams, and it's hard to replicate. And you can see P.J. Fleck, and I think he's talking about that play getting outside more than even that goal line play. But once again, watch this power run. It's not complicated. It's one of the best left tackles in football, Ramczyk. Now, they'll do different pullers. At times, you'll see the guard or the other tight end. Well, this time, it's actually Fumagalli. And watch this. Watch this target. Look at the left tackle pile drive. And it's that block right there that's going to create the seam. Right? And that's what you need. Targeting is a bad word on defense. There's nothing better in this scheme than being able to target and drive your defender into the ground.
Well, Ryan Ramczyk, a consensus first team All-American and first team All-Big Ten at left tackle in his first season at Wisconsin. He was recruited by Paul Chryst originally to Pitt, but decided that was too far from home, so went the Division III route to Wisconsin Stevens Point. For a couple of years, sat out last year after transferring. And by the way, he's also playing hurt. He has a torn labrum in his hip. He already knows he's going to have surgery after the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic, and yet he's out there with his team, and he is just washing down that front for Western Michigan.
Yeah, and Dare and Corey and the rest of them appreciate it. And I love what Paul said to us yesterday about Ryan. You know, the build-up to the Cotton Bowl, all the reporters around him, and his teammates were laughing, saying, that guy's not said three words to us this season. What can he possibly say to 10 reporters?
That's Brock Ewart. I'm Bob Wischusen. Down on the field, Allison Williams. So a huge drive here, you'd have to think, for Western Michigan. They desperately need points. Zach Terrell to throw on first down. Comeback route, and it's there for Carrington Thompson. And that looks to be good enough for a first down. Now maybe short by a half yard. They'll spot the football down for second down and a half yard.
Well, here's your grit, and here's your guts. And Wisconsin's going to play a man-to-man, and you're going to have to win those matchups.
Pitch, and a tackle broken by Michael Henry. To the 45-yard line. A gain of 11.
I think even the most devout Bronco follower knew coming into this game there would be some challenges, but they were going to have to win offensively, and you too have got to get your blocks. And you can see the very slight receiver there, Carrington Thompson, just a buck 78. It's not about size and strength at the time, but your willingness. And just in the nick of time.
Possible change of the play for Zach Terrell after the look over. A crease up the middle. Jarvion Franklin. He's got a first down, a gain of 12 and a half. Our first opportunity to say hi to Chris Cotter.
Hello, Bob and Brock. Let me tell you some college basketball news here. Head coach at Duke, Mike Krzyzewski, is going to leave the program on Friday to have back surgery to remove a fragment of a herniated disc. Jeff Capel will take over. Coach K will coach on Wednesday against Georgia Tech, and then it'll be about a four-week-long recovery process, guys.
Interesting. That's a lot of adversity for Duke to deal with early on. The injuries to all the freshmen. Now they've got the Grayson Allen tripping and suspension situation. Now they lose their coach, Zach Terrell. Down the sideline, and it looked like stepping out of bounds was Corey Davis as the officials' hats fly. So Jordan Shelton, the best corner in terms of coverage for Wisconsin. Would you match Sojourn Shelton all day on Corey Davis, follow him around?
No, they are. And that was one of the challenges with Penn State, because they shared the ball and distributed to all their playmakers. But there is no doubt, Justin Wilcox said, wherever Corey goes on the perimeter, Sojourn Shelton, number 8, will follow him. And that time he wins the one-on-one matchup.
Well, now he's in the slot. The slot right at the top of your screen is Corey Davis. Maybe that's where he'll live in this game if that keeps Shelton off of him. Terrell, slant, incomplete. Arrington Thompson, the intended receiver. And now it's third down and 10.
And those are the shots you got to hit. For Western Michigan, you know, they can't get into third and extra long against this crew. And you can see the window. It opens. Pretty good patience. Just a miss. And that's a shot that Terrell normally hits. And when you now miss that, you put yourself right into the teeth of these edge rushers.
Could be four down territory for Western Michigan, down by two scores, depending on what happens on this play. We'll see.
It's a man-to-man look.
Here comes the blitz. Terrell under pressure. Dragged down. T.J. Watt, 11 and a half sacks this season. Number one in the Big Ten.
That's why he's going to be a good pro. We saw him on the first third and extra long, just beat the first team all-conference tackle Okorafor, and this time shows you the versatility coming inside, and that's a mismatch. It's one thing to have a left tackle. Fabian Johnson's about 5'6", 200 pounds. He's their third down back. But Watt's just too good for that matchup.
Well, double-digit sacks at Wisconsin, that's not even something that J.J. Watt accomplished. Getting the punt away is Coleman. Flag out. DJ Fleck was looking for a 15-yard personal foul. This may be only the 5-yard variety, though. I think he was disappointed that his team wasn't going to get a free first down.
Running into the kicker, defense, number 85, 5 yards, replay fourth down.
That's Xander Neville.
This is pretty close, Bob. One of those little judgment calls there the officials have to make between roughing and running into. And typically when a punter is that compromised, one thing to go to the feet. You saw that in the Alabama-Washington game. In that semifinal, the right call running into. You know, that one could have easily been called roughing. And no surprise here, PJ wants to go back on the field and at least put yourself in a position for a possible fake.
Yeah, these teams have had a month to prepare. Once you get across the 50, if you're going to fake a punt, this would be maybe the chance to take. Although fourth down and 15, that's a long distance to have to cover. So instead, another opportunity on the intentional end-over-end kick. Well executed. And Peavy made things interesting. Fair catch inside the 15-yard line. Well, experience the college football playoff national championship at Playoff Fan Central. Free for every national championship game ticket holder. Enjoy appearances by school bands, cheerleaders, mascots, mini pep rallies, interactive games, sponsor activities, and much more. Friday, January 6th through Sunday, January 8th at the Tampa Convention Center if you're there. For more information, please visit collegefootballplayoff.com.
No substitute for experience. Years ago, we had a play in a game where the punt returner bobbled the ball and then ultimately fumbled it. But the defender did not give him the chance after that bobble to make the catch. And by rule, you have to. He could continue to bobble that ball when he signals fair catch. You've got to give him the opportunity, Jazz Peavy in that case, to make the play.
Now it's Alex Hornibrook getting a chance at quarterback to start this drive. And he'll start it by handing to Corey Clement. And that's a loss of about 3.5 back inside the 10-yard line. So how do things change now for the Wisconsin offense, if at all, with Hornibrook in the game?
None. you're going to continue to run the ball. Mr. Houston's looking up at his stat line saying, I was perfect on third downs, two drives, two touchdowns, and now the redshirt freshman who's going to get every opportunity to lead this program after Bart plays his final game today, he'll get his opportunity in the Cotton Bowl.
Ogunbowale. Well done that time by Western Michigan. Andre Turner brought him down right at the line, and now a huge opportunity for the Broncos. This should take us to the end of the first quarter, and the play of the game for Western Michigan on defense right will here. Most likely begin the second quarter.
And Allison had the report from Ed Pinkham and David Duggan, the linebacker coach for the linebackers. Not about the linebackers. Those two plays were about David Curl and Andre Turner. The big guys at least given the rest an opportunity to do their job.
Wisconsin lines up, but the clock goes to all zeros. What a first quarter, though, for Wisconsin. They rack up 104 rushing yards in the first quarter alone to take the lead here at the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. But they're faced with third down and long to begin the second quarter when we come back to Arlington. Welcome back to Arlington and the 2017 Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Just about set for the start of the second quarter, and a huge play and an opportunity for the Western Michigan defense to try and get their team back in the game. Wisconsin has been terrific so far, and Taco Bell is bringing the best of the regular season to the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic by creating the Taco Bell student section. Today they're picking up the tab for students from each school so their passionate fans can root on their teams. Hornibrook back to throw. Long throw to the sideline. Is it good enough for a first down? George Rushing makes the catch, a yard shy. That was a really good throw outside the numbers by Hornibrook, but Rushing broke off his route just short of the sticks.
This is a long throw all the way across the field, about as far as you can throw a comeback. And he has to come back and make that reception. That is awfully, awfully close to the sticks.
And that looked as if Wisconsin may have gotten the short end of that spot as well. Darius Phillips is a lethal return man. Will he get an opportunity? Nope, fair catch at the 35-yard line. Still pretty good field position for Western Michigan. And a spot here, Brock Huard, where it just felt in this game as if the Broncos defense had to have that stop. Not even an eventual right. stop on that drive. They needed that stop to get off the field and give their offense some field position.
It's strange to say that first play of the second quarter to have a have to, but when you're a team that's built on some of that emotion and you're going up against a bigger, more physical opponent, you need something good to happen. In third and 12 and finally getting off the field was just that.
It only makes a difference, though, if the offense now moves down and makes it count, because the Wisconsin defense has been just as good as their offense. Zach Terrell has to throw it away. Let's check in with Allison.
Well, guys, I couldn't agree more with what you just said. The Broncos needed that stop for the mere fact of they needed something positive to happen. The sideline's been a little stoic, a little quiet, and you can see the frustration building just in the body language and from some of the guys that did shout out. And remember, coaches told us that that first quarter was going to be really important for them to adjust to Wisconsin's size and speed. So being able to get the stop there, huge for their confidence.
You'd have to think there has to be a bit of a shock value for an undefeated team to now get pushed around a bit the first quarter by Wisconsin.
And to not play this style all season long.
Terrell off play action. Steps up in the pocket. This time he'll tuck it under and get what he can. Picks up about 3.5. Leon Jacobs brought him down. But it brings up another big third down.
And we called a Wisconsin game earlier this season against Northwestern, and that entire game was about first and second down. As most of the opponents Wisconsin has faced, you're looking at the fourth most efficient defense in college football. And if you get into these third and passing situations, we've already seen it with Watt twice. They move their pieces around, they blitz, they're willing to play man coverage in those situations, and they're so difficult.
Corey Davis in the slot to the near side right on third down and 7. Terrell Instead, right to the sticks. Carrington Thompson. That's good enough for a Western Michigan first down. A fifth-year senior who spent 2 years at Northwood Junior College before coming to Kalamazoo, and that is a big first down conversion. Wisconsin shows blitz. Jamari Bogut finds a crease. Nine more.
A pretty good look there of not Wisconsin's offensive line, but Western Michigan's rather. Well, playing a little of Wisconsin kind of ball. And look at the big fellas. And Wisconsin knew that this was not your typical Mac O-line.
Diving forward for a first down is Bogan as he picks up a couple.
And now a little mix of tempo. And you're down 14 in Western Michigan, the fourth best in college football time of possession, Wisconsin number one. But Wisconsin rarely picks up the speed at all, and Western Michigan is capable of doing this, and I think the right move. Don't let those guys on that other side put their hand in the ground every time and get a good look at you. Be willing to mix tempo, quick snap, as they did there.
Jamari Bogan into the heart of that Wisconsin defense for a gain of 2.5. It is a two-headed monster at running back. Jamari Bogan at only 187 pounds. Jarvion Franklin at 228. They're roommates. They've been roommates their whole careers. They're best friends. It's an interesting relationship. Terrell goes up-tempo, flags down. And it's a false start.
False start. Offense, number 77. Five-yard penalty. Second down.
That's the first penalty on Western Michigan.
Oh, when you see the frustration right there in P.J. Fleck, he doesn't show that a whole lot. He's not had many moments where he's been frustrated this season. But you set yourself up. You got a second down situation. That was going to be a shot play. And he knew it. I think his, unfortunately, left tackle knew it as well, trying to get into his pass set. It's a missed opportunity, and P.J. knows it.
Chukwuma Okorafor. And Taylor Moten, both tackles on this offensive line, have an NFL future in the eyes of the scouts. The officials still trying to figure out if they've got the ball spotted correctly. It should be second down and 12 from about the 45-yard line. Looks like they robbed Western Michigan of about a yard. Terrell, that ball batted around at the line and almost intercepted. It ends up on the ground. Garrett Dooley just about picked it off. And now it will be third down and long.
A really good play there by Chikwe Obasi, the defensive tackle. Wisconsin's got a ton of pass breakups this season, 55, in fact. That's yet another top 10 stat. Big reason why those D linemen have a savviness and awareness.
And these third downs is where we see Wisconsin really become an NFL defense, aren't they?
Here come the blitzes. Here come the stunts. And Western Michigan trying to get a feel for what that can look like, trying to get a feel for coverage as well.
They have to call timeout. Play clock winding down.
Timeout. Western Michigan, second charge for this half.
That might have been the best thing for Western Michigan, getting organized before third down and a long 12. Bob Wischusen, Brock Huard, Allison Williams back in Arlington. Let's go back to the false start that put Western Michigan behind the chains.
Yeah, not many times you see a left tackle split out, and that's why PJ was eating his call sheet. They wanted to get to this shot play, felt like they had an opportunity. The Chooks, that's the nickname he goes by, in a position he's not normally in, flinches on the perimeter. Obvious false start.
A lot of moving around near the line for Wisconsin. How many are coming, and where will they come from? It's a four-man rush. Terrell out of the pocket, extending the play. Across his body. And now what do you do if you're Western Michigan? Jarvion Franklin made the catch. It's fourth down and about six.
You got to go.
Inside the 40-yard line, down by two scores.
Yeah, I think you got to go. If PJ is true to his word and what he told me in this building yesterday, watching practice, is we get across the 50. I love going for it anyway on fourth down, but in this matchup in particular, we will be aggressive.
And why have they not been able to get the ball to Corey Davis beyond the first play of the game from scrimmage? That's his only catch.
Now that's because those Wisconsin defenders know it, and they're playing a lot of games in their coverage, rolling over the top, trying to disguise their multitude of looks.
And the play clock winding down again, and they have to call timeout again. And that's what PJ Fleck must do. Western Michigan uses their final first half timeout. So it's fourth down and a long five when we come back. Welcome back to the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Fourth down, 5.5 for Western Michigan. True to his word, PJ Fleck said, we will be aggressive. They're going for it to try and keep the drive alive and get on the board. Only a four-man rush. Terrell has it tipped. Still it finds its way to Corey Davis. His second catch. And it's good for a fourth down conversion.
And that's why the NFL loves him, because he's not just a perimeter player. I highlighted Watt on the other side being an inside and outside rusher. That's a one-on-one with a safety right there, an undersized safety. The MVP, Leo Musso, of this Wisconsin defense, and he shows you the strength. He's got speed and acceleration. He's got strength. He's got tremendous hands. And you're going to the right guy at the biggest moment in this game.
Jarvion Franklin. Strong run. Lost the football. It's on the deck. A scramble for it inside the 15. All the way down inside the 10. Wisconsin thinks they have it. Derek Tindall at the bottom of the pile comes out with the football.
The number one team in America, they're taking care of the ball. The program for PJ is built around the ball. He's going to have to hope that the left elbow of Franklin was down, but you're looking at a Wisconsin crew that's also +8 this season. +11, 8th in the country. That right elbow down?
Very close.
It's under further review.
When you freeze frame it, it certainly looks as if you can make the argument he's still got the ball when the elbow hits. Leo Musso is literally ripping it out just as the elbow hits the deck. It was ruled a fumble on the field, Brock. So it has to be indisputable video evidence to overturn the call. Would you say that that is without doubt he's down?
You make an excellent point. It's about what is called on the field. You go frame by frame by frame, and that left elbow looks down. But boy, is this close. I think you can make a case. I think you can make a case that left elbow is down. But if I've got to say make the case, that does bring indisputable into play.
And one thing the replay booth will often ask for in moments like this is also give us one look at or two looks at it full speed. Because sometimes full speed, if he's obviously down, then it gives you a better idea. If it's that split second close, let's take another look. Wow.
It's as close as it gets. And both these programs are built around the ball. Number one in America, number 8 in America, +19, +11. Why they're on this stage, why they're playing in the New Year's Six Bowl, is that the job that they have done. Western Michigan, their first 6 games of the season, 0 turnovers for PJ Fleck.
Now they were the last team in FBS to cough the ball up. Well, here's the decision.
After review, the runner's knee was down before the ball came out. It was second down. At the 22-yard line, second and 4.
Well, I think that was probably our referee misspeaking. It looked like the elbow being down was more the determining factor. And that is a big break for Western Michigan as the elbow is deemed by replay. As we take a look at two looks that are perfectly in sync, and this is something they also have access to in the replay booth to give them as much information as possible, they deem that he is down. And it turns into a 6-yard gain, second down and 4. Play clock down to 4 again. Zach Terrell with a trap handoff. Jamari Bogan.
So why all that time? Why the double look over to the sideline? One of the real challenges for Western Michigan in their league, they play a lot of two safety looks. Wisconsin is not. They are a one safety team. They love to play what they call post defense, one single safety. And that means that other safety is coming in and out. He's rolling. He may be doubling somewhere. And it really makes it, even on the top scholar athlete in college football. And that is what Zach Terrell was. Difficult to get that feel and read. And that's why you're trying to take this time.
Bogan breaks a tackle. Jeter bugs down into the red zone. T.J. Watt missed him at the line. And he gets down to about the 17-yard line for a gain of 5.
And this is why they've won 15 in a row. Second only to Alabama, as you see T.J. Watt actually huffing and puffing, not a 3-and-out, not being able to just rush the passer. But this is why, because of their ability to be balanced against the T.J. Watts and the good defenses and hands on hips and breathing hard. You do that by running the ball right at them as well. Not just a one-dimensional team here for Western Michigan. More than capable of pounding it, which is what they've done in this drive.
Second and 5 at the 12, and again the play clock is winding down. Here comes a blitz. Terrell to the outside, right up against the sideline, incomplete. Harrington Thompson couldn't stay in bounds. Now it's 3rd down and 5.
Well, the last 3rd and 4th and 6 went to their best player. They finally got Corey Davis a chance, and it's one of the advantages of the big screen up here, and everybody looking up and watching the big screen is Watt. He's gathering himself. That looks like a catch.
That might be good. P.J. Fleck wants the officials to take another look. Play clock is down to 9. And now replay will buzz down.
Rolling on the field with an incomplete pass. That play is under further review.
Yeah, P.J.'s hot. He didn't have a timeout. So he can't force that issue in conversation, but he's screaming and yelling because they're all watching the screen. Carrington, the senior, tremendous body control. That's good in the NFL. That's right foot. That's dragging that left toe. Now, does he have control of the ball all the way through contact of the ground as well? It's that entire process.
It seems as if the official that ruled that play incomplete wasn't even concerned about whether or not he had complete control of the football. He wasn't looking over at the football. That seems to be an inbounds, out of bounds call, because that's an immediate incomplete with his eyes right down the sideline.
Well, he's in protection mode. I think what he's worried about is getting run over right there. As he was, you want those side judges to be on top of the play, but not quite literally.
After review, the receiver had complete control of the ball with his right foot inbounds and went out of bounds at the 7-yard line, 1st and goal.
Huge catch by Carrington Thompson, and it is 1st and goal, Western Michigan, midway through the second quarter.
These Broncos got some guts to them, don't they?
You don't go 13-0 by accident.
And the coaches tell you you're built on, and that resolve comes from overcoming early failures. You're seeing it played out here. Been easy to roll over against a more physical team, but you're responding in a big way.
Corey Davis at the bottom of the screen. Jamari Bogan down to about the 5-yard line, maybe just inside the 5 before he's brought down by Dakota Dixon.
Pretty solid. You'd love to be around 75%. Most of the elite teams hit that mark over the course of the season. And you get that way because you're able to run it. And you're able to create that push. And you've got two all-conference offensive tackles, second-team all-conference center, and getting pretty good push on the big fellas up front.
Bogan again. It'll be third down and goal at the two. And it will be the 16th play of a drive that has taken nearly 9 minutes off the clock.
Four down territory. You can't go backwards here. But to me, I think I have seen enough. Pretty confident here that you're getting some of that initial push. Bogan's a tremendous short yardage back. You can see how low to the ground he is. If the numbers are right here, and this is a check with me system, and they bring their big package in, their second tight end, 38 Miller. Watch QB keep as well.
Play action. Terrell on a bootleg. One on one. Makes a cutback. He's into the end zone. That's a Broncos touchdown.
Advantages to being a walkthrough. At the Sugar Bowl last year, we saw that fun throwback screen to Laramie Tunsil the day before. It was something to watch practice yesterday, and that was a look. If they got it, they were going to run QB keep and have the confidence in their fifth-year decision maker to make the right decision.
16 plays, 65 yards, 8 minutes and 46 seconds. Before that touchdown is scored.
Let me tell you a little something here. Your heart rate gets up when you pull that ball. You know it's you, one-on-one, out in space, and it's all about you and your ability to make the play, and that's exactly what Terrell does.
That looked like Brock Ewart.
No, it didn't.
Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Committed to honoring blimp-worthy athletes who demonstrate hard work on and off the field. Goodyear, official sponsor of the college football playoff. Bob Wischusen, Brock Ewart, Allison Williams, the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. It's a 7-point lead now for Wisconsin. And of course, Monday, January 9th, 8 Eastern, right here on ESPN. It's the college football playoff national championship game presented by AT&T in Tampa, Clemson, Alabama. Brock Ewart, what do you like?
Ooh. That Alabama defense is nasty. And defense won championships. Knicks won 4 of them with the defense. And as much as Clemson wanted Bama, Bama's defense wanted another shot at Deshaun Watson.
Eric Mitchell through the back of the end zone. And let's take a look at today's good hands play brought to you by Allstate. And this goes back to the opening drive. Troy Fumagalli. This is pretty.
On 3rd and 13, safety right over the top. The underneath coverage actually holding, trying to get a hold of Fumagalli. He fights through it. Cowboy Stadium does his best. Jason Witten right there to make the 3rd and 13 conversion. Wisconsin's had the ball 3 times, 2 touchdowns, and then we're in an NFL building. This feels like, possession-wise, an NFL game. Is two of the best in college football at possessing the ball or doing just that in the first half.
Back to Bark Houston at quarterback. Play action on a rollout. Bark Houston under pressure, and he'll go down. A loss of a yard. Now, Brock, you're a quarterback. I know you talked about this with the game day guys a bit. How unsettling would it be for you to have your play caller change a week ahead of the national championship game with Lane Kiffin out, now Steve Sarkisian taking over?
They know infinitely more than any of us do. And what they know, and I think I'm making an assumption here because we're on the outside, is Nick Saban said, Lane, go coach at Florida Atlantic. Go do your thing. And I got the guy that I wanted anyway. The guy all the way along when I brought him as an analyst this season to call the shots in the biggest game of the year.
Another jet sweep. Jazz Peavy finds a lane down the sideline. Jazz Peavy finally bumped out inside the 25.
And that's the exact play they ran against Minnesota in the 4th quarter. Tied against Minnesota, final season, final regular season game. Is that play? It was that exact concept. Two tight ends, a wing alignment. Once again, tremendous job on out on the edge. Darius Phillips, corners, loses contain. Fumagalli not just catching it, but blocking. And Jazz Peavy this time the beneficiary, where Cephas has been already twice this game.
The seventh play already in the game of 20 yards or more for the Wisconsin offense. Corey Clement driven back, looking for room. He lost about five. Keon Adams blew that play up for Western Michigan.
And there's a negative play they need. You're not going to get very many of them because of penalty. Wisconsin, one of the least penalized teams in the country, so you're going to have to do it with effort like that from the senior Adams, who gets underneath the pad level there of the big fellas, gets into the backfield. But containment, I think containment been the number one issue. The P.J. Fleck and his defensive coordinator, Ed Pinkham, going to have a conversation with his linebackers, his corners. There's been such a hyper focus on that power run game between the tackles. You can't lose focus on the perimeter run.
Play clock down to two. Ogunbowale. He's brought down right at the line. It'll be third down and 15. And Brock, if this game feels a little like an NFL game, it's because that's the way these two teams play. This is only the fourth offensive possession for Wisconsin. Western Michigan's only had the ball three times. Well, they're both in the top four in America in time of possession. So they're used to playing deep into the play clock, shortening the game, and now third down and 15 forced by the Bronco defense. Five-man rush. Bart Houston, long throw to the sideline. Jazz Peavy's got it. Check that. That's George rushing in front of Sam Beal. And it's a first down, a gain of 16.
Paul Chris said to us yesterday when I asked him, hey, you've gotten over that Penn State loss? He said, yeah, pretty quickly, because they just won four of the most critical one-on-one situations. And right now in this first half, Wisconsin has done the same. It was Fumagalli on the opening drive. That time, it's just one-on-one. It's a deep comeback to the field. You know, that's the one area Western Michigan is willing to give up, and Wisconsin taking advantage.
Corey Clement inside the 10-yard line, down to about the seven.
And those are so hard defensively, Bob. You've done such good work. You've gotten yourself into a third and 15 against a team that's not very adept at throwing the ball. And PJ knows it. If we would have told him, hey, you're going to get Wisconsin to third and 13, third and 15 in the first half, he'd have taken those odds and those shots.
And Bart Houston's 5 for 5. Does he now become the quarterback the rest of the game?
I would think so.
Clement brought down just inside the seven. Very important third down coming after that tackle by Asante Brown. Coming up at the half, we'll check in with Adnan Virk, Danny Cannell, Joey Galloway. They're standing by the Buick halftime report. They'll get you highlights from the Outback Bowl and, of course, preview the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. All that just over a minute from now. Third down and 3 inside the 10.
They liked the matchup of Fumagalli coming into this game. Felt like he had an advantage of both size and speed. We've seen it early. He's right here.
False start. That was David Edwards, the right tackle, that bounced back and got flagged.
False start, offense number 79. Since the clock was running, disqualified for a 10-second runoff. However, Wisconsin has chosen to use their first timeout of this half to avoid a 10-second runoff.
Hey, 54 seconds. Paul Christ avoids the 10-second runoff. Wisconsin now down to two timeouts remaining. First Take is moving to ESPN on Tuesday. That's right, same time, different place. You can catch Stephen A., Max, and Molly. They'll continue to discuss and debate, mostly debate, the most compelling and entertaining topics of the world of sports, just on ESPN at 10 a.m. Eastern to noon, streaming live on the ESPN app, and watch ESPN. And now Paul Chryst has made the decision that we were saying during the break he should have made.
And we didn't even debate.
Paul Chryst, as we went to break, opted to use a timeout rather than take a 10-second runoff after the false start. But you've got all three timeouts. Take the 10-second runoff. That's just 10 less seconds for Western Michigan. You've got all three timeouts and down to 37 seconds. You control the clock, but a big third down here, third and eight.
Keep an eye here.
Houston. Looking end zone, Fumagalli had it in his hands and couldn't hold on.
It's pretty cool to have a month to get ready. And you heard Tom Blackledge yesterday, 2 days ago, I thought just killing it in that Alabama-Washington game. All the prep that you do, you start to really zero into the matchups, and this is what you wanted. You get your big tight end, and Troy made a phenomenal play on an early third down, just enough distraction to get in the way. But Troy's going to tell you, I got to make that play for my quarterback.
Andrew Endicott from 30 yards out. He's got it. But a red zone defensive stop for Western Michigan.
And they'll get the ball to begin.
They won the toss and deferred their option to the second half. So PJ Flex team is going to have the opportunity to start the third quarter with the football. Now, wide angle lens. If you're Western Michigan, you gave up 100 rushing yards in the first quarter. You just got a red zone stop, though. You had a long drive of your own. I mean, the way this game started, I would have to think you're pleased to be down 10 points and in the game at halftime.
I think after PJ gets down encouraging them, there's just going to be a couple things. I think really defensively, start to eliminate that perimeter run. Make them earn it inside, right? By having that focus with your eyes to not let that perimeter run get outside of you. And then on third and extra long, they may have to mix it up a little bit. Right, they may have to bring a little pressure, get a little help outside, because third and 13 and third and 15, those are long odds, and Wisconsin's converted them. And give Bart Houston a ton of credit for it.
Well, his only incompletion was what should have been a touchdown.
That's right.
That drop by Fumagalli should have been a score. Should he be the quarterback the rest of the way? Do you give the fifth-year senior the opportunity to finish?
I think so. I like playing the redshirt freshman and giving him a series, but if he's earned it before and he's done nothing but play brilliant football and lead you to three scoring drives, he should have every opportunity to finish it.
Allison Williams going to catch up with Paul Chryst before he heads to the locker room at halftime, and he will ask that very question: who's your quarterback the rest of the day?
And I think on this side of the ball, PJ had to like that last drive. Nearly 9 minutes, a sustained drive. They ran it, you know. They were able to push a very physical, now healthy Wisconsin front. And if Wisconsin wanted to play around with the numbers and the secondary and the safeties, Western had to be committed to running it. They were on that drive and got their 7 points to make this a very different game than what it felt like about 10 minutes ago.
So the undefeated Broncos will have the ball to start the second half, down by 10. Wisconsin, a terrific Wisconsin-esque first half. Controlled the line of scrimmage, ran the football very effectively, well coached, and earned a 10-point halftime lead. Let's head down to Allison.
Thank you very much, Coach Chryst. First of all, how have you managed to keep Western's high-powered offense in check?
Well, I don't know. I mean, they had a pretty good long drive, you know, converted on the fourth down. You know, we're doing some things, making some plays. We're obviously, we've got a lot of football left. I don't know if we're keeping it in check, but, you know, we're doing some things there well. And yet there's some things we feel like we can clean up and need to clean up.
Bart Houston, 5 of 6 so far. How does his performance affect if or when we see Alex Hornibrook?
Well, Alex had the one drive when we were backed up. You know, she had the one series. And, you know, we'll see them both again in the second half. And we just got to, you know, find a way to finish it down there. I mean, that's what's in your mind right now. And you know, they've done a pretty good job. We've been playing on a long field, and a couple times we're able to flip it. And we just got to regroup and clean up a few things and come back. And obviously, a lot of football left.
All right. Thanks, Bob. Look forward to it. Bob.
Paul Chris does not waver from the game plan. He is sticking with two quarterbacks in the second half. 10-point lead for Wisconsin at the break. Adnan, Danny, and Joey. The Buick Halftime Report after this quick timeout. Welcome back to the 2017 Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic from AT&T Stadium here in Arlington. Just about set for the start of the third quarter. And Wisconsin, very much true to their style in the first half, a 10-point lead over Western Michigan. What's so much fun, I think, about watching Wisconsin play, they are as unapologetic as any team in America about how they play, what they do. Hey, we're not flashy. We stick to our guns, and it works for them.
And they're like an NFL team. They're really well coached. And I would debate you if you find me five better groups, especially defensively, that are better coached than Wisconsin. And you saw it play itself out to me in that first half against the game's one of the game's best at wide receiver in Corey Davis. And it was key and critical for the Broncos to get Corey involved. Very first play of the game, he catches a little glance route. But since then, watch the movement of the defense of Wisconsin. That's Musa. That's right over the top. That's what we call cloud coverage. That's showing the quarterback one look and now showing him a very similar look. Is the safety going to come over the top? Are you going to double team? Or is he going to get back into center field and allow that pass rush to go and feast? And when finally Western Michigan got their best player involved, it was a fourth down. A must fourth and six. And there you see some of the size and strength advantage to finally get the matchup on the undersized Musso and win. But getting Davis some big opportunities, he's their touchdown maker, 18 of them on the season. And finding ways to craft positive matchups for him will be part of the theme here in the next 30 minutes.
Only 32 yards receiving in the first half. Corey Davis this season had 130 or more yards receiving in four halves of individual games. The only player in the country to put those kinds of numbers up. Well, look, he's got more yards than any player in the history of college football at the FBS level in receiving. So he's closing in on 5,300 career yards, not an accident.
Yep.
Where they want to go with the football. And when you have a well-coached defense and you know the number one weapon and who he is, you roll coverage his way.
Take him away and see if they're going to be patient enough. And on that 16-play scoring drive, it was 10 runs to six passes. It was the willingness to take a 2-3-4 yard run. If they want to try to disguise all their coverage, just get back to pounding the ball. That's what Western Michigan did on their touchdown drive. And won't surprise me if they begin the second half in much the same vein.
Darius Phillips back deep to receive. Will he get a chance at a return here? No, this one rolls into the end zone. And a moment ago, Allison Williams caught up with PJ Fleck.
Coach Fleck, Wisconsin rushed for 156 yards in that first half. What adjustments do you need to make to your run defense?
Well, they're an incredible football team. Got to give them a lot of credit. They're well coached. They're doing what they do really well, better than what we do well. And that's what we got to change in the second half.
How can you get Corey Davis more involved in the offense?
Well, they're double covering him a lot. And I would, too, if I was them. We got to move him around a little bit more, get him at number three and three by one. Number two, bring him on the backside. Do some different things with him, too. But they're doing a great job over there.
PJ, thank you.
You got it, really.
How many coaches do you think have that response when they get through the first half against Wisconsin? They're doing what they do well.
And they're doing it better than what we do well. And we're the ball.
Jarvie and Franklin is the tailback to the right of Terrell to start off the third quarter. Terrell's first look not there. Extends the play. And picks up about a yard. Chased down by Vince Beagle.
And that guy will play in the league, too. You know, he's another one of these, probably not as high a draft pick as T.J. Watt. He's not maybe as explosive, but that man can play ball. Over 50 games in his career as a Badger, Vince Beagle.
A fifth-year senior that had a broken left foot earlier this season and opted for surgery and missed the games against Michigan and Ohio State. That was a tough pill for Vince Beagle to swallow. But made it back in his team now in the New Year's Six. Terrell under pressure again. Steps up in the pocket, tucks it under again. He's got the first down. Eventually tracked down by Leo Musso, but not before he picked up 12.
You know, you heard Danny and Joey at halftime talk about the game that follows us in that Rose Bowl game where Trace McSorley's going to play. And there's some comp here with Zach Terrell and the run that he's been on. And just the critical plays when this team and this group has needed it, right? And that's it right there. Instead of third and 10, He's able to scramble. He's able to move the chains. And for this group, they've got to get that tempo going. The only way you do is to churn out some first downs.
This is Jamari Bogan. Forward progress. The ball pops out. And who's got it at the bottom of the pile? It looks like Western Michigan will hold on to the football, and quickly Bogan comes off the field.
It's all about the ball, and that's now both running backs, Franklin and Bogan, that have coughed it up. But no surprise, it's what Wisconsin does. Look at the finish. Look at the 2-3 Badgers, and they're ripping. And you see the big fella, the right tackle, Moten, coming in and recovers it. That's now three opportunities, a batted ball, two fumbles, one overturned. Was called a fumble on the field, overturned. Near misses for Wisconsin defensively.
Play action, slant, knocked down at the line by T.J. Watt. Now, how eerily similar the start of T.J. Watt's career, where he has now gotten to at the position he now plays, to his brother J.J. It's almost the same story.
It is. Maybe a little more beat up, you know, a couple injuries, started as the tight end, and then a couple injuries.
And a walk-on ends up being a premier pass rusher.
Development, the key of the ball game there in Madison, and why they've been so successful for so many years.
Third down and eight. Four-man rush. Terrell again steps up in the pocket. Long throw on time. Corey Davis. First down, and takes a shot out of bounds as well.
Well, he takes a shot after delivering one to Leo Musso, and you heard PJ say to Allison, we got to move him around. He's got to get in the slot. This was the fourth and six conversion, and that's a bit of a mismatch. And Leo was the team MVP, voted by his peers on that squad. But that's, you know, 5'10", 190 going up against 6'3", 213, and very skilled in the slot. Larry Fitzgerald has shown you this season, leading the league in receptions, there's a lot of damage to be done in the slot.
Travion Franklin. First down, gain of six.
You can see there with Corey, and PJ knows it. PJ, a former receiver himself, you can't keep him stationary, and you can't allow that defense to dictate. And by you moving him and him being adept enough to play in the slot and X and Z, you give a very different target for that defense trying to defend.
Right up the middle, Beyond Franklin, inside the 15. First and 10 at the Wisconsin 13. 23 on the carry for Franklin.
That's tremendous movement at the point of attack, too. Highlighted Wisconsin, rightfully so, for their run game. And that's not power, that's just zone running, but that's winning in your double teams. That's moving the 300-pounders off their spot, allowing the big man, Franklin, and he is big at 225, to get going downhill. You got one-on-one to the bottom.
Terrell again instead looks up top. End zone. Incomplete. Harrington Thompson, the intended receiver. Metrell Jamerson was underneath in coverage.
They're one-on-ones. This is what you got to win. You win off the line, which typically means you're going to finish. We've seen now both difference makers. Fumagalli on the other side, a very similar reception that both of those guys, Carrington, Thompson, in that case, he feels like he's got to make that play. All the attention going the other side, get my one-on-one, got to finish.
Now it's Bogan. Down to about the 10-yard line. Talked earlier about how Jarvion Franklin and Jamari Bogan are basically best friends. Bogan's from New Jersey, Jarvion Franklin from Tinley Park, Illinois. And Franklin said when he first met Jamari Bogan, he said, that is as loud as I've heard anyone ever talk about 2 feet away from me. Which, of course, being a New Jersey guy, I got a chuckle out of. It's the way we talk. So poor Jarvion Franklin got baptism by fire. Third down and seven from the 10.
He is lined up outside, got the entire field, a tight split, meaning lots of room and grass to throw to. And you see Paul Chris calling a timeout on the other side. I don't think he likes that matchup.
Timeout, Wisconsin, first charge of this half.
So Wisconsin uses their first timeout here in the second half. Big third down when we come back. Coverage provided by Goodyear, committed to honoring blimp-worthy athletes who demonstrate hard work on and off the field. Goodyear, official sponsor of the college football playoff, and Brock's clicker shows us why Paul Chris called that timeout.
Yeah, you're going to see him running down the sidelines. He is right here, and he's making the call because look at all of this space for Corey Davis. You don't want the best player on the field to have that much room to operate.
Well, Corey Davis is basically after the timeout in the same spot. You see the adjustment from Wisconsin after the timeout?
Not right now. And let's see if they do post snap, that single safety possibly flying out and be right here to help cover.
Terrell looking towards Davis off his back foot, hoisted in the end zone, incomplete. Chikwe Abasi was all over Zach Terrell and forced the off-balance throw.
Yeah, and I don't like that, Bob. That's one of the first times I think I've said that for either staff or call today. But when you've got a difference maker like that, and that's the matchup you want, I don't think you want to run post corners and have to rely on those extra time in that moment. Just run an inside fade where you have that whole area to throw to in that back pylon. That's a miss.
Butch Hampton, the true freshman, has made 12 of his last 13, including 5 for 5 in the MAC championship game. This one from 27. And he stays red hot. And it's now a one-score game 5 minutes into the third quarter.
Paul Chris said this game was going to come down to the one-on-one situations and who would be the one to come up with the play, the catch. Both have missed. Carrington Thompson right through the hands.
Texas is home to one of the best football factories in the world. The Big Game Football Factory moved to North Dallas a few years ago and manufactures many of the footballs used by the NCAA. And we have a big game here, the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. And it is now a one-score game between Western Michigan and Wisconsin. Now the Badgers about to get the ball for the first time, Brock, here in the third quarter.
Run, 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 run. 22 runs, 7 passes. That should not change. Over 150 yards rushing that first half. Mixing inside and out. Stick to your guns.
And it will come out to the 25-yard line. Coming up later on ESPN, two more games for you. We kick it off at 5 Eastern in the granddaddy of them all, the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual, USC and Penn State, and wrap up the day with Auburn and Oklahoma in the All-State Sugar Bowl. Both games streaming live on the ESPN app. And watch ESPN. And the number 5 team in the college football playoff hasn't fared all that well.
Yeah, I think this number 5 wants to play. And two of the most traditional old school uniforms, helmets, playing in the Rose Bowl.
Corey Clement, straight ahead run. Stood up and driven back. No gain on first down. I'm Bob Wischusen here with Brock Huard. Allison Williams on the field. Is this a drive with Bart Houston now at quarterback where if you're Wisconsin, you just want to exert your authority and
yes,
be the big red machine again?
That's right. That's right. Be who you are. And they will not panic. They've been in so many close games this season against top teams. They feel as if they're battle tested. I don't think they'll in any way deviate from their plan coming in.
Houston, swing pass. Clement in the flat. And it will be third down in about 5 and a half. Robert Spillane came up to make the tackle.
That's an excellent tackle in the open field as well. We saw earlier Ogunbowale, very similar concept, get down the sidelines. And quality teams don't repeat mistakes. That's how you get to New Year's Six games. You see it, you adapt. Much better job there by Spillane and his buddies in a very big third down conversion here.
Houston underneath Fumagalli. He's got the first down.
Those big tight ends are a quarterback's best friend. There is nothing better on an easy, high percentage throw right in front of you to see that number. That's what you're looking for as a QB. I want to see that 8 and that 1. That in-breaking route, just get in front. Just get that big body in front. Show me your numbers. I'll protect you and get the first down. You knew he was going to be a factor coming in. That's the one matchup they really wanted to feast upon, and they've done so.
A walk-on from when Brett Bielema was the head coach in Madison. Flags down.
That's going to be the right tackle again.
This is like an eclipse. Another pre-snap penalty.
False start. Offense number 79. 5-yard penalty. First down.
That's now the fourth penalty in Wisconsin on the season. Is penalized 3.3 times per game. He's just trying to get a little extra edge.
Only Navy was penalized fewer times this season than the Badgers.
And when Paul Chris says to us going into halftime, we got to clean some things up, that's it. I mean, those are the plays in this style of offense. Pre-snap penalties you just typically can't afford.
Ogunbowale. It'll be second down and about 13. Another tackle made by Western Michigan's leading tackler, Robert Spillane.
He's just getting out in front. He's just getting out in front of those blocks. They were catching him early, right? You got to feel that size and that strength. And those Western Michigan Broncos, no matter how much time they spend in the month of December, there is nothing you're going to do like game action to feel that speed and that strength. And you see Spillane there, the quickness to get out in front of the block.
Houston steps up in the pocket. Another check down to Ogunbowale, met again by Spillane. And now it'll be third down and 10.
And here you go. It was third and 13, and it was third and 15. And Bart Houston converted both on a seam route, on a comeback. Looking at third and 10 right now.
Wisconsin's 4 for 6 on third down, and they have not, as you said, all been third and 2 and third and 3.
In the big one-on-ones outside, you see the tighter coverage now. Press man adjustment in the second half.
Here comes the blitz. Houston is hit. He will go down. Spillane got there first. The blitz gets home. And Western Michigan gets a third down stop.
Pretty simple stunt here. You see every college football team run it. And the analyst loves to say a double A-gap gut blitz, and that's what it was with Spillane. And Ogunbowale knows it's coming. Once again, there's quickness. There's P.J. Fleck saying our strength, our quickness has got to be theirs. And that time, Spillane beats Ogunbowale for the sack.
Darius Phillips has 5 non-offensive touchdowns this season, one of which a punt return for a touchdown, but he lost the ball. He tried to get the head start, and Western Michigan avoids disaster.
Again.
Looks like it might be Drake Spears at the bottom of the pile that saved the fumble by Darius Phillips. So the Broncos still have the football, but it was this close to a giveaway. Bob Shoes and Brock Ewart, Allison Williams with a look at the blimp-worthy moments brought to you by Goodyear. And both teams took time out this week to visit with young patients. Wisconsin spent time at Texas Scottish Rite Hospital. Western Michigan went to Children's Medical Center in Dallas. Brock, it's a great bowl tradition, one that you lived as well. You have any memories of being a player at UW and, and making these hospital visits bowling?
You know, eating steaks and wings and everything else and bowling is fun, but there's nothing more meaningful than that. And you do remember that for years and years to follow.
Jarvion Franklin starts this drive at tailback to the left of Terrell. Play action. Terrell again steps up in the pocket and gets out of harm's way and picks up about 7.5 yards on the scramble. Allison?
Well, we've seen Western's backs cough it up twice. So running back coach Kenny Burns was telling them, chin the ball. What does that mean? They want 5 points of pressure, not 3. They want it on the rib cage and under the chin. That's how they need to carry the ball. He told them, Wisconsin is strong. You've got to chin it. And as soon as there's contact, 2 hands, guys.
Wow, that's well done, Allison. I think she can go coach those guys up on the sideline.
Second down. And a long 2, close to 3. Right at the first down line to gain is Franklin.
Well, here's the conversation I'm having. If that's the conversation on the Western Michigan side, Justin Wilcox and his defensive staff, Noki Brechterfield, his D-line coach, to me, that's been some of the story here. That 16-play drive, it was runs like that. You know, it doesn't look like much, but Justin knows this, that he needs to get these guys in those third and passing situations where it's advantage Wisconsin instead of third and manageables. And a lot of that is those runs. You've seen two wonderful scrambles from Terrell. This front four here, this group right here, has got to step up in the final 18 minutes of action.
Play clock down to five. In motion goes Davis. It's a reverse. Back to the quarterback. Terrell throws it back across to Davis. Blockers out in front. That was a lot of work to pick up about 5 yards.
And that's where it was designed to go. I mean, typically you've got a guy down the field, but you don't see many options down the field. They wanted to get this back to Corey Davis, expected the over pursuit, and you don't have it. I mean, Wisconsin stays at home, but here's a little of that strength. He catches it, and that's 10, 12 yards after the catch. That's the difference with 84.
Isn't that, though, emblematic of what makes Wisconsin such a great defense? That's a lot of window dressing, and they just didn't fall for
it.
Gave up 5 yards. Hogan, much simpler play call and a much more violent hit. Dakota Dixon, third team all Big Ten, came up and hammered down Jamari Bogan after a gain of a yard and a half. Third down and three.
And
now Terrell, they want to go quickly. And they will. And they don't get it. Ryan Conley, a former walk-on, only playing because Chris Orr, Jack Cicci, linebackers like that went down with injuries earlier this season, a much bigger role than he was expected to play, and he makes an impact play.
And sometimes you can hurt yourself by going fast. Sometimes you want to do that if you can really get that defense misaligned, but I think you talked about that beautifully, Bob. These guys typically don't. And a timeout here from Western Michigan, and unfortunately, Okorafor, an opportunity there to get to the linebacker. He couldn't with the quick snap.
Is there a chance P.J. Fleck is calling this timeout to think about going for it?
No doubt about it.
Welcome back to the 2017 Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Bob Wischusen, Brock Ewart, Allison Williams, and Brock, a miss on that third down a moment ago.
Yeah, one-on-ones don't have to be just receivers and cornerbacks. They can be left tackles against linebackers. Wisconsin confused. Look at them. They're not even lined up. But look at this one-on-one situation here. You just get a body on a body, you win. And instead, the former walk-on Conley does what Wisconsin guys typically do, and offensive coordinator Kirk Shiraka is fuming up in that booth, knowing a missed opportunity there on third down.
Low snap, but James Coleman gets it away. And it is fair caught inside the 15-yard line by Jazz Peavy. Well, again, as soon as we are done, we will head to Pasadena. The Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual, and has there been a player in college football this year whose team has rallied around his emergence more than Trace McSorley at quarterback for Penn State?
Yeah, that's a great question, Bob. Yeah, very, very few. And really the confidence that he brings, just a gamer. You know, three of our broadcasts we've done, and I think every time we've said, he's the one on the playground you pick to win. He's not the biggest, the prettiest, the strongest arm. The kid just finds a way to win.
And don't let the score fool you and think Wisconsin's nervous. This team doesn't get nervous. They are so used to playing in these tight games in the second half. Jazz Peavy. End around. And there's the adjustment, staying home, ready for it that time. Western Michigan. Well, talking about how both teams have rallied around their quarterbacks, the streaks that USC and Penn State have been on heading into the Rose Bowl.
Yeah, two of the hottest teams. I mean, Alabama has the longest winning streak, followed by Western Michigan here at 15. But talk to any analyst at the end of the season, what they say, you don't want to see USC. They got two bona fide NFL offensive tackles. They're playing tremendous ball in all phases. And Penn State, just simply ask Wisconsin, is as hot as anybody.
Houston, play action. Steps up, long throw. Fumagalli makes another terrific catch over the top of Darius Phillips.
Can't do it better than that. P.J. Fleck's going to say, that's my best cover guy. My best cover guy on our team. And Fumagalli, like these elite tight ends at the next level do, they win. You're covered. Right by the textbook, you're covered right there. You are in his chest plate. That tight end, Fumagalli, the confidence that Bart Houston has in him to go up and high point it, body control. Can't do it better now.
Wide receiver hitch, Robert Wheelwright. First down. Across the 50. Asante Brown eventually made the tackle. But two snaps for Wisconsin, and they are across the 50-yard line.
I thought it was telling yesterday when I asked Paul, have you gotten over that Penn State loss up 28-7? He kind of looked at me like, you know, a lot of people look at me with questions at times and said, get over it. There's three 50-50 balls. And they made the plays, and we didn't. He wasn't making excuses, not giving Penn State the credit, but they made those plays in those situations, and that deep shot to Fumagalli, I think, really illustrates that one-on-one nature of it.
Lemon with the stiff arm. Runs a man over and picks up another first down. Boy, does that energize the sideline? Justin Tranquil ended up underneath Corey Clement and that stiff arm, a gain of 12.
Patience. Slow to explode through. And it's a hard trait for young running backs to learn. And it's taken Corey a bit of time. Maybe more time than the average fan would have thought or believed. A four-star kid, very talented. Five 100-yard games, seven out of his last eight, because he's shown more patience than ever.
Lent again. Bowls his way inside the 35, down to about the 33 for a gain of 4.
And that should take us to the fourth quarter. And once again, big game, Bob, you nailed it. They will not flinch. They will not deviate from who they are. There is no program. I shouldn't say no program. There's others that do it that way and have that level of patience as well. But it doesn't matter the coach. And Paul Chris knows the blueprint. P.J. Fleck does as well. And that's the danger of playing an opponent that knows itself so very well.
One more snap off before the end of the quarter. And Clement brought down right at the line of scrimmage. Maybe a half-yard gain. So a very important third down when we start the fourth quarter. And P.J. Fleck wants his team ready at the other end for the final 15 minutes. 7-point lead for Wisconsin over Western Michigan as we head to the fourth quarter of the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Missed opportunities for Western Michigan. P.J. Fleck knows it. For the start of the fourth quarter of the 2017 Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. I'm Bob Wischusen here with Brock Ewart, Allison Williams. It's a one-score game and a big third down for Wisconsin inside the Western Michigan 35 to open up the fourth quarter.
And the kicker, Endicott, just 4 of 10 from 40-plus yards.
Clement up the middle. Stopped well short. Fourth down and 3. Nathan Braister helped to trip him up. Does Paul Christ trust his kicker to try and make it a two-score game, or does he stick with his offense? Looks like they're staying on the field to go for it on fourth down.
Yeah, you had time between the quarters to say two plays to get 5 yards, boys. 2.5 yards.
You think that call on third down was indicative
100%.
Of the fact they made the decision to go for it on fourth down?
Without a doubt.
Western Michigan shows blitz. Here they come. Bart Houston checks it down. Fumagalli again. Flag thrown in the secondary. But he has been the offensive MVP, making big plays in the passing game. Let's check the marker, though.
Offensive pass interference, number 44. 15-yard penalty, fourth down.
Yeah, and Paul Chris doesn't like it. And this is about as much emotion as you're going to see from Chris, because he gets what he wants. He's expecting man-to-man coverage on fourth down. He wants a rub route, the concept right here. He wants these two guys to try to brush off defenders. The problem, the 260-pound Steffes runs right into the defender. And PJ's calling for it. And you got to be a little subtle. Sometimes hard at 6'5", 260 to be subtle. Hard for NFL receivers at times to be subtle.
And that, of course, now forces Wisconsin to punt on 4th and 18. Darius Phillips lets it bounce inside the 5, and it will roll down inside the 3. Perfectly covered by the Badgers. And Trell Jamerson at the 3-yard line is able to down it. The NFL playoffs start with the wild card game on ESPN and ABC Saturday at 4:20 Eastern. 12-4 Oakland, 9-7 Texans from NRG Stadium. It will also be streaming live on Watch ESPN.
Paul, Chris didn't like it. And he didn't like it because Fumagalli had the defensive end beat anyway. There was no need, unfortunately, there for the tight end Steffes. And you can scream that was bad. That was really bad. Unfortunately, what was bad was the big tight end not subtle enough to duck under that contact. That will draw the penalty flag.
The punt, though, got the ball down inside the 3-yard line. So Western Michigan backed up down by 7. Terrell straight back to throw from the end zone. Up the seam, and it's picked off. Intercepted by T.J. Edwards. He originally committed to play at Western Michigan. Ends up at Wisconsin and now burns the Broncos.
Now those surrender Cobras are out from the Bronco fans because they have never seen this season. There have been 3 interceptions. That's it. 2 of them were on tip balls. 1 was on a bit of an overthrow, but not into coverage.
Having said that, though, that is the 22nd interception this season for Wisconsin. They were number 2 in FBS picking balls off. So you've got one of the best defenses at taking
That's
it
right.
away, going against one of the most efficient quarterbacks at not giving it away.
Yeah, and the former Bronco commit couldn't have done it any better reading the eyes.
And now Alex Hornibrook is back in a crucial moment in the red zone. Here at quarterback, hand off to Clement. A yard and a half on first down. Allison.
Well, guys, T.J. Edwards has to be ecstatic after that interception because, as you mentioned, he committed to row the boat with P.J. Fleck prior to his senior year in high school. And this picture of him getting ready to do just that surface at a team meeting during bowl prep. As you can imagine, the entire team erupted. They've been ripping him all the last couple weeks about his commitment to Western. But, guys, he said once he had an opportunity to go to Wisconsin, it was his dream school. He just couldn't pass it up. But you can imagine the guys have been letting him hear it, getting ready for this game against Western.
Well, no doubt. I think he redeemed himself. 2nd down and 9. Another handoff to Clement with a cutback. Very interesting now, Brock. You've got 3rd down and about 7 inside the 10-yard line. And the cold quarterback comes off the bench, and Alex Hornibrook. What do you call here if you're Paul Chris?
Well, you're going to call Fumagalli because they've not been able to stop him. I mean, the only incompletion for your offense was a ball that Troy can catch and stopped on that last passing play with a pass interference. You're either going to go to 81 or you're going to use him as the ultimate decoy and distraction.
3rd down and about 6. Wisconsin can get a 1st down, as you can see inside the 2. Hornibrook off his back foot. Fumagalli. Guess what? Touchdown.
See a good tight end at Penn State in the Rose Bowl that follows us. Kid that makes a lot of plays just like that for the Nittany Lions. And Troy is saying, give me my opportunities. Let me feast upon the matchup that is most favorable for our offense. And they have once again stuck to who they are and never deviate from their plan.
Back to a 2-touchdown lead for the Badgers. T.J. Edwards, the one-time Western Michigan commit, ends up burning the school that he once planned to go to. And it must be nice if you're a quarterback to have a matchup you win all the time. Fumagalli just keeps on winning. here at the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. And Troy Fumagalli has made impact play after impact play. He's been the favorite target for Bart Houston and Alex Hornibrook. And that last touchdown puts us back basically where we started. Wisconsin scored the game's first 14 points. Western Michigan responded to make it a one-score game, and now they will need a big response in the last 12 and a half minutes. And once again, they'll have to start at their own 25-yard line after we check in again with Chris Cotter.
All right, gentlemen, let's talk about what's happening in the Outback Bowl over on ABC. Florida completing a drive here with Austin Appleby finding DeAndre Goolsby. So it's 17-3 right now, Gators over on ABC, guys.
Well, so far, this has not been a great bowl season for the Big Ten. And right now, Wisconsin with a 2-touchdown lead in the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic, of course, coming up next. We've got the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual, where Penn State will be in the bright lights. But Big Ten has had a somewhat forgettable bowl season so far. Jarvion Franklin on a swing pass. Takes on two Badgers and has forward progress close to the 30-yard line.
Well, this is where you're going to lean into if you're Western Michigan, your seniors that have been there before, have been through adversity like Zach Terrell, to not panic. Wisconsin didn't on the other side, down 17-10, and the momentum in this building turning a little bit, and they never flinched. And if you're Western Michigan and you're Zach, you've got to continue to take what's there. Justin Wilcox and Wisconsin will demand it with their defense. I'm going to try to keep everything in front of them. And you got to be patient enough with 11 minutes to go in this game to know you still have ample opportunities ahead of you.
Terrell under pressure again. Dumps it off. Coming back to help out the quarterback, Corey Davis. And he has a first down by about a half yard.
He's strong. Who does he look like, Bottom? You call NFL games every weekend.
Anquan Boldin.
Yeah. I was talking to the scouts. This is not a great receiver draft. I think he's got every opportunity to be the third guy. Mike Williams at Clemson's coming out.
Yep.
John Ross did not have as good a game against Alabama. Not many do. He's projected to be the second. And this kid, especially if he runs well at the combine, he'll be the third guy drafted at that position.
Bogan. To about the 42-yard line. Well, this is an offense that can score. They average just under 44 points per game, top eight in FBS, but they didn't play at any point this season a defense that looks like this.
No, in fact, as far as defensive efficiency goes, PJ Flex Crew saw one in the top 50, and that was Northwestern at 37, who held them to 22 points. Wisconsin, number four in the country, so many areas in the top five, and efficiency-wise, number four in the land.
Bogan has a first down to the 50-yard line. Had to work hard to get it. But Western Michigan is just about to cross into plus territory against a defense this year that against Big Ten opponents allowed 13.7 points per game. Only Michigan, of all Power 5 teams, allowed fewer points per game in conference than Wisconsin did.
Which makes that 28-7 lead in that Big Ten championship game against Penn State so hard to swallow, but not affecting their effort today. You knew they would come out energized, would want this challenge, and had just not given up the big play.
Terrell rifles one, and he's got a hookup with Michael Henry. How about this response from Western Michigan down to the 24-yard line against a Wisconsin defense that put up terrific numbers all season? Except there's a penalty marker.
Offense number 77. 10-yard penalty. First down.
And it's Chukwuma Okorafor, the left tackle, again. That gets called for a penalty, and that is a backbreaker for Western Michigan.
And that is, unfortunately, the right call. And you're going to see Garrett Dooley never give up. Another edge rusher. It's right here. And you get your hands outside the frame. Hard for those big fellas. They're expecting that quarterback to be in the pocket. That quarterback escapes. The defensive end, that outside pass rusher is going to flush, and you just got to do your best to not tug the outside of those frame, outside the shoulder pads, especially in clear view. You're going to get that penalty called against you.
Okorafor began playing football as a sophomore in high school after his family came to the U.S. from Nigeria. Swing pass to Franklin. Spins. all the way down to about the 42-yard line. And the play finally blown dead. About 2 yards shy of a first down, a gain of 18.
And that's a nice call by Kirk Ciarrocca up in the booth. We showed him earlier a little bit frustrated, but he knows going up against an elite defense like this, third in the country, got to take advantage of the opportunities when they present themselves.
Quick snap, and on third down, able to keep the drive alive. Again, it's Franklin, met by T.J. Edwards, but moves the pile for three. Now, Western Michigan certainly has the firepower to come from behind and score a couple of touchdowns, but these are two teams, as we talked about earlier, that chew on the clock.
Yep.
They're both top four in time of possession, so you have to start counting possessions here if you're Western Michigan and maybe go with a little more of a sense of urgency. You might only get the ball two more times in the last 8.5 minutes. Terrell. Michael Henry. Picks up about 8, maybe 8.5. Well, this college football bowl season, stream every game live on the ESPN app and on Watch ESPN. Download the app or visit watchespn.com today. Worked a lot of college basketball with Dan Dockich. His line about the ESPN app and Watch ESPN, best invention since the fourth. And I agree, during college football bowl season especially.
You have a one-on-one to the bottom.
That's where Terrell's looking. Slant, scooping it up. Corey Davis, first down. Wisconsin sideline says incomplete, and now an official from the Wisconsin sideline runs all the way across the field and says no catch.
Third down.
So it will be third and about 1.5 yards.
It doesn't take long for these players to look up at that big screen. I think that's the right call, and the official all the way across the field can see that. That's well done by this crew. Obviously hits the ground. That's a big miss. Setting up a third down.
And what you'd have to think is four down territory as well if they don't pick it up here. Hogan. Very close to the first down marker. And without measurement, the officials say move the chains.
Over. Low man wins. And there's some advantages. They list Bogan at 5'7", your New Jersey buddy. That's a close talker.
Thank you.
Yeah, look at the face mask to face mask here. Watch this. Bam! Close talkers, those New Jersey guys willing to stick their face in there. And they said Bogan may be undersized, but he's our better short yardage back. Proves it right there.
You
runs
say
right
that.
Through Jacobs.
You say that like you have some idea of what they're talking about.
Some?
A lot. Play clock down to 2. Terrell again steps up in the pocket. This time he's got nowhere to go. Lost the football. And there is Taylor Moten, his right tackle. I think that's Moten's second fumble recovery, avoiding 2 Western Michigan turnovers. Vince Beagle was all over Zach Terrell.
And the space in the air just suffocating in that pocket. You've seen Terrell scramble, and that time it was the tight end Ernsberger, clearly the ball out. And once again, you know, 4 different fumbles on the ground. Western Michigan's had the benefit of getting back.
And look at the clock. Down to 6:38 to go, 2nd and 13. They need 2 scores. At some point, Western Michigan's going to have to pick up the pace. Terrell swings it right. Again, it's caught by Franklin. Lost the ball again. This one, it looks like Wisconsin has taken away. Oh, it looks as if after T.J. Watt knocked it out, Jarvion Franklin somehow found it at the bottom of the pile. Another fumble. Wow. That the Broncos are able to find a way to avoid giving away.
And how Garrett Dooley, number 5, does not recover that fumble.
It almost looked like clear recovery as the play was happening. Third down. Under 6 minutes to go.
And here's your one-on-one, but I'd be surprised if he doesn't get a little help to the top.
Slant, and this time it is cradled by Carrington Thompson. A gain of 10 and a big third down conversion with 5:39 to go.
That's a big time throw. That pocket now a little bit more room, and when he's had some of that space to stand and deliver, Terrell's done what he's done largely all season. Throwing it with confidence. But you made the point earlier, and look at this. That's, again, what elite defenses do. They're number three in the country. Make you earn it. Make you earn every third down. Make you earn every yard. You don't give up the free play. You don't give up the explosive play.
Another look over, and that continues to wind the clock down. Play clock at 7. Hand off to Bogan.
And here's another 30 seconds. You know, Wisconsin doesn't want to give up those kind of yards, but at the same time, and you can look at PJ, man, the clock is ticking. You're under 5 minutes. You're not going to have many possessions left. I mean, this is time you got to pick up your pace.
Well, the way that they are playing this drive, and as much time as coming off the clock, even if they score here, they'll probably have to onside kick.
Or trust their defense in the timeouts.
They only have 2 timeouts left, and this is a drive that's already taken about 8 minutes off the clock. Terrell lost the ball. Was his arm coming forward? It looks as if they will call that an incomplete pass, and rightfully so. Garrett Dooley, one of many different Badgers that have collapsed the pocket. Get Alec James on the rush as well. He knocked the ball away.
Yeah, that's called taking the blocker and throwing him right into the quarterback. I'm not going to rush. I'm going to take my guy and I'm going to drive him right in the lap of the passer. Where's 84? Where is 84? Where is the opportunity to the bottom now of the screen to use his frame, use his size? And Mamuso, the safety, come help right over the top. Yes.
Instead, they'll run it. And now it'll be 4th down. TJ Edwards wrestled back Jarvion Franklin. And you wonder if now Western Michigan might use a timeout before the 4th down play.
I don't think you can afford to do that. Already burning one this half.
It looked as if PJ Fleck was poised to call one. Instead, his team gets set to try and keep the game alive. 4th and 4 with under 4 minutes to go.
This has got to be your best player. 84 has got to have an opportunity here. And once again, Sojourn Shelton travels with him.
Terrell looks the other way instead. Extends the play. Now on his horse, hoisted into the end zone. Is it caught? Touchdown! Corey Davis!
Had it the whole way, Bob. Just as you designed it. Paul Chris says, incredible. Everything that I possibly want. And the Western Michigan faithful saying, there's a reason this team's won 15 in a row, and it doesn't matter if it's 4th down heroics thrown up totally off rhythm. Smart. Give your guy an opportunity, at least go and get it. And there's that strength.
Wow. Yeah. Joe Montana and Dwight Clark have nothing on Zach Terrell and Corey Davis.
Not as pretty.
16 plays, 75 yards. It took 9 minutes off the clock. Did he miss the extra point? He did. Butch Hampton pushed it wide right. Still a one possession game. 3:27 to go. But now Western Michigan needs a touchdown and a 2. The only reason they're even in the game is because one of the best wide receivers in college football made one heck of an effort play. Welcome back to the 2017 Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Still a one-score game. 3:27 to go. But now Western Michigan has to kick it off, and we will kick it off Monday, January 9th at 8 Eastern here on ESPN. The College Football Playoff National Championship game presented by AT&T. Clemson, Alabama, Raymond James Stadium in Tampa. Here comes the onside kick for Western Michigan. They get the big bounce. Jazz Peavy had it go off his chest plate, but out of bounds. 3:27 to go. The game's not over yet because Western Michigan still has 2 timeouts.
Yeah, the punter, Justin Mitchell, 10-year minor league punter, gets the kind of bounce you want. You want to put the pressure on Peavy there. And like we've seen so many times today, the ball on the ground over and over and over. Mostly for the Broncos, and Wisconsin unable to recover. And that time, PB does just enough to get it out of bounds.
It comes down to Western Michigan just about having to have a three and out. They've got two timeouts, 3:27 to go. Corey Clement up the middle. A 2-yard gain, and it looks like PJ Fleck is going to save those two timeouts for now. So let's go to Chris Cotter.
All right, gentlemen, Outback Bowl over on ABC. Iowa trying to come back down 17-3. CJ Beathard picked by Chauncey Gardner. Talk about being there. Gardner, a freshman, takes it to the house. 24-3 right now. Florida on top over on ABC.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. Second down and 8. Clement again. Cut down at the line. Devontae Ginwright made the stop. And the timeout is called by PJ Fleck. Huge third down when we return. We've got about 1 hour before we kick it off in Pasadena. Trace McSorley for warm-ups, leading the Nittany Lions out of the locker room as they are on the field at the Rose Bowl. It's the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. The Nittany Lions, the Trojans, as soon as we're done. How soon will we be done, though, here in Arlington?
Give me my best play. The other team's got to score 8. This isn't the NFL with a running clock. Get me the very best play I can. 12 of 13 completing balls today as well.
So you would throw it if you had that look you wanted on third
down. You haven't stopped Fumagalli yet.
Play action. Mark Houston looks up the seam. Unbelievable. Troy Fumagalli adds to a career day.
Of 14. The only incompletion was off the fingertips of Fumagalli in the end zone.
Should have been a touchdown, yeah. The one that he dropped.
That's right.
Bart Other Houston. Than that, Bart Houston's perfect.
But money. Absolute money in his final game. Fifth-year senior that's earned this right. Couldn't play better. I mean, he was perfect other than that one drop. Look at that. What a smart play to go down. You want to say a play that just epitomizes a well-coached team, why they win year after year, why they're such a tough out. They don't beat themselves.
Clement pulled down, and PJ Fleck will now spend his final time out as they get the stop at the 20-yard line. And now for today's Capital One pivotal performance. Was there ever an easier choice to make?
Why does 6 for 83 and a touchdown not do this justice? It feels like he's had 200 yards and 15 catches. They've been in every variety. The gorgeous one-handed catch. The body control, the former walk-on, 240 pounds to go up, to elevate. I said to you earlier, there's no better best friend than a big old tight end that creates mismatches everywhere. People say it's a run game, yes. And the run game can often get you in a position where you need to rely on that weapon. It's been a joy to watch, huh? And it's been just fun. Why you said to open this day, like, this is the day. This is where we all get to hunker down and watch football. And you just watched quality football. My team's not penalized. Teams know who they are, what they're about, and Corey Davis doing what Corey Davis has done in his career, and Fumagalli having a brilliant day.
And that's the thing. We did Wisconsin's game against Northwestern earlier this season that impresses you the most when you're around this program. They are so unapologetic about who they are. This is how we play. It's not wild spread, throw it all over, red gun football. We line up, and we mash you. And then we throw play action. Here's Clement. Down to about the 15-yard line, but no timeouts now left for Western Michigan, so they need a miracle.
And you know what? They return a whole lot of people next year. I'm looking at 9 seniors on my board defensively that should start for Wisconsin next year. You're going to get Jack Sitchy back, who was your best player defensively before he tore his pec. This whole O-line is going to be back. If Ramczyk, who's going to have hip surgery, makes that decision, Corey Davis won't. He'll be moving on to the NFL. And as they look at that big screen, it's pretty evident to them. They went toe-to-toe with the big boys. They were not overwhelmed at any moment. They fought back the entire way. But in that moment of truth where you have to get it done, Wisconsin did.
A handoff to the fullback, Austin Ramish. First down. Down to the six. And now Wisconsin can go to victory formation.
And just Toham win another 11 games and lose the three games by one possession and put yourself in position next year. This should be a top 15 team. Fumagalli is going to come back. As I said, the O-line will have to replace Corey, running back. But they do. And they're going to win another 10 games next year. And who knows, in those one possession games, they may make the catches against Michigan next year, or Michigan State, or Ohio State, or Penn State in that championship game like the Nittany Lions did and Paul Chris guys did this afternoon.
And look at P.J. Fleck gathering his team on the Western Michigan sideline as Bart Houston starts the clock rolling down on inside of 40 seconds to officially end the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. But P.J. Fleck wants his team to know that they have nothing to be ashamed of, because the Wisconsin Badgers are a tremendous football team. And Paul Christ, congratulations on an 11-win season.
How about this, Bob? As those two embrace, how about the Cotton Bowl crowd here? And so many attended from Kalamazoo, all standing and applauding the effort. That's what you want on this day. As we're going to turn it over to the Rose Bowl and Sugar Bowl. You know, you want a game that you can stand up and applaud, and both of these teams more than deliver.
Let's head down to Allison.
Well, Coach, I know how eager your team was to get out here and play. What does it mean to come away with a victory in the Cotton Bowl?
Well, it means a ton, you know, and it's the last time this team plays together, and to be able to win against a good team, really proud of them, and it means a lot.
You went with the senior at quarterback, Bart Houston, to start, and throughout much of the game, what did he show you today?
You know what, I thought our team was kind of who they are. You know, Bart competes and made some big plays throughout the course of the game, and Alex came in, you know, throws a touchdown pass for us, but we thought all along for our team to be the best it could be, needed everyone, and today was an example of, we needed a lot of guys.
You mentioned big plays. How about the play of Troy Fumagalli? What kind of mismatch did he provide you out there?
Fum was big, you know, and maybe that's why it was a little bit of a mismatch to the side, but he was clutch on things. How about TJ Edwards' pick? You know, that was the one time I think where we had him backed up, and TJ comes up with a big play, and then we're able to capitalize. Now, there's a lot of things. You go back and look, to win a game against a good team, you need a lot of plays, and we made enough.
You mentioned the pick, and they say defense wins championships, and you did so overcoming some injuries at that linebacker position. What are you most proud of with that defense?
I'm just proud of the way they played, and so many guys were a part of a really good defense, and it was a defense that was fun to watch, and you know, we're far from perfect, but they were good. They led us this year, and yet it took everyone. It was fun. This big Cotton Bowl has been unbelievable to us, and to be able to come out and win it means a lot.
Paul, thank you so much for the time. Congratulations.
I appreciate it.
Over the last 3 years, only Ohio State, Clemson, Florida State, and Alabama have won more games than Wisconsin. That's a tough way for Western Michigan to end what once was a perfect season. Up next, the H&R Block College Football Pregame, followed by the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. For Allison Williams and Brock Ewart, I'm Bob Wischusen. So long from Arlington. Reese Davis, take it away.